Hello, people. And I see the participant numbers going up. Look at the excitement. People are here because they heard that Ashley Petty and the Young Professional Network put this together, and that Ashley was so interested in the content that she left her own wedding early to be here with us. So congratulations to Ashley Petty, the YPN chair, on both doing a wonderful job with YPN and in getting married this weekend. Congratulations to you, Ashley.
Thank you.
And where did you get married?
In Klein Tahoe.
In Klein Tahoe, was it beautiful?
Oh my God, it was stunning. We were so happy.
And Ashley is a twin, and we are curious, some of us, if your twin was your best woman. What do they call that?
She kind of was. She's not that type of person to take on that responsibility.
Got it. Okay. And at any point, did she show up in a white dress, and did you say to her, what the heck are you doing?
Good Lord, no. No, but she did walk my dog down the aisle.
That is awesome. Any wedding that includes dogs walking down the aisle, I can get behind. Mm-hmm. I performed a wedding about 6 months ago for the parents of my dog's best friend. So my dog's name is Parry. His best friend is Millie. We all met at the dog park, and I performed the ceremony, and the only two non-humans there, of course, were those two dogs.
It was adorable. Amazing.
He was the plus one.
Oh, for sure.
Okay, so welcome everyone. We have approximately 100 participants. I think it is time to get started. I'm not sure what the official title of the class is. In my notes, it says the best TIC class ever. That's what my notes say. So we're going to try to live up to that. This was brought to us today by the good people at YPN. You don't need to be young to be in the YPN, just young at heart, which is why David was excluded. And welcoming today the following panelists, we have Ashley Klien, who is an attorney and a partner at the KDV law firm. Ashley specializes in real estate. She is a wonderful friend to the real estate community. She is a member of the SFAR Board of Directors. And on June 16th, I'm having dinner with her and my wife and her husband, and looking forward to it. Thank you for being here.
Thanks, Dan. I think we just got 99 new people at dinner, so that's lucky for us.
I didn't tell them where.
Okay, that's good.
Yeah, I didn't tell them where. I only told them when, so that they know when to be jealous.
Yeah, Steve James is coming.
Speaking of which, David Parry is a good friend and a colleague, and David is a real estate broker who was with the good people at McGuire for years and years and years. And although David is not officially a director of risk management, he might as well be. And he has guided so many of us over the years, having chaired the forms committee both here at San Francisco and at CAR. He was my introduction to both the forms committee and to the board of directors. David is a past president of the San Francisco Association of Realtors and a current director at the California Association of Realtors. He is my friend. His wife, Lauren, is a good friend. And David, because I mentioned Ashley, this is time for us to get a dinner date and some rummy cub on the calendar with you and Lauren. David, thank you so much for being here. Among other things, David was instrumental in drafting all of the COPA forms and most of the TIC forms that you're going to be using, and is a wonderful expert. Thank you, David.
You're welcome.
And Sam, I just got to meet today. Sam Clonmell, pardon me, is with the Bank of San Francisco. He has been with the bank for 7 years, but has been doing loans for 12 years. If and when he turns off his video, you will see a very impressive, what do they call those glamour shots? Oh God, I forgot what they call them. But anyhow, it's a very impressive picture of him in a blue suit with a fantastic tie. Maybe we can ask him to do that at some point. But more particularly for today, he has wonderful experience in TIC loans. In fact, Sam was telling me that virtually 90% of the loans that he does himself at work in his portfolio are TIC loans. And although he does not own a TIC, I asked, he knows all about the financing and will help us through that part of the discussion today. So welcome to Sam.
Thank you, Dan. Happy to be here. Looking forward to talking more about TICs.
Great. And I know that I embarrassed you, but people want to see it. So at some point, you got to turn off your camera.
I'll have to. It's on the hook now. It'll happen.
I appreciate that. Thank you. All right, everybody. So what is a TIC? I think that's where we're going to start, right? So what is a TIC? And so Genevieve, maybe you can throw up some slides and we'll get there. And of course, a TIC refers to tenants in common. And as Ashley and the other lawyers love to tell us, a TIC is a way to own, it's not a thing. And so Ashley, what exactly does that mean? It's a way to own, it's not a thing. Let's advance a couple of slides.
So I think the most important thing to keep in mind here is that a tenancy in common is a group of people having an undivided ownership interest in a property. So people often want to think about TICs as condos. You know, this is, I own this unit. No, you own an undivided interest in a whole. And so it's popular in San Francisco because what we figured out contractually from a legal perspective is how to give people who own an undivided interest in a whole certain rights and responsibilities associated with that sort of ownership interest while still maintaining this TIC structure where you own 25% of 100% of the building.
And do you own an undivided interest in 25% of every square foot of that building?
I mean, technically, yes. And then what happens is the TIC agreement is going to govern where you can go. So if you and I, Dan, own, I own a 50% TIC interest in our building and you own the other 50%, without that TIC agreement, maybe I'd have a right to use your part of the property. But luckily, we have these great TIC agreements and they make it so that I can't go walking into your unit and eating your food in the middle of the night.
Let's not give away everything yet. Let's go on to the next slide, which is a TIC versus condominium. And so when we talk about the distinction here is that a condominium is in fact a different thing. And so David, you have sold many a TIC and you've sold many a condominium. If you had a preference, if it was the same exact four unit structure, would you think it more valuable as a four unit building, which could then be used as TICs, or would it be more valuable if it was built and originally entitled as four condominium units?
It's more valuable as condominiums, whether it was built that way or converted over time. I've done six condo conversions on my own buildings in the last 35 years. So all of those, I started with TIC partners and then went through the condominium conversion process when that was straightforward to do. The city, of course, has started or has for some time limited condominium conversions. And so that's led to the establishment of TICs and as we'll see shortly, individual financing for those TICs.
You know, that couldn't be a better segue to the next slide, which is why are TICs needed and popular? And so actually there was one slide in between there, was there not? Why are TICs needed? Oh, you know what? There we go. TIC versus condominium. There we go. And so then we don't have, Genevieve, give me one more slide. Let me just see if it's still there. Nope. Okay. And one forward. Okay. So we've taken out a slide. Mr. Parry, when you edited, you took out a slide. And that slide is exactly what you just said, which is why are TICs needed and popular? And the reason is condo conversion has become very difficult and it is disapproved by the city. And so the city right now has a fast track condo conversion process for certain two unit buildings, but the process for converting threes and fours and even higher is on hold. Now that might be resurrecting itself soon, and Ashley may or may not want to tell us about some of those rules and what might change in the future. But for now, let's test our knowledge between the difference between a TIC and a condo. And imagine, if you will, two exactly alike four unit buildings, physically identical. They were built at the same time, but one of them was entitled as condos. One was just a four unit building, and the people decided to come together as TIC co-owners with a TIC agreement. In our little hypothetical, a neighbor hires a locksmith to get keys to your unit and starts to sleep in your bed, and you call the police. Now, if the police show up and it's a condo, and the police say, is this a condo? And the answer is yes. Do they arrest me when I sleep in David's bed? David, do they arrest me?
I hope so, yes.
Yes, and hopefully they do. But what if when they show up to arrest me, I say, wait a minute, it's a TIC. I own a 25% undivided interest in the whole building, including this room where David is sleeping right now. I'm entitled to be here. Do they arrest me?
It depends if they're sophisticated enough to see the difference.
Yeah, and if they are sophisticated enough to know the difference, then they don't arrest me because I'm not trespassing, right? And they say, you need to sue David because David, this man who's sleeping in your bed, has breached an agreement. And that's a contract between the two of you. That's a lawsuit, not an arrest. And so when we put it like that, it helps us understand the difference between a condo and a TIC. Let's go on to the next slide. And so this is where we're gonna lean on Ashley. And Sam, don't worry, you're gonna get in here soon when we talk about financing, I promise you. But for a moment, we wanna talk about what is in this typical TIC agreement. This is that document that binds these four owners and regulates what they can do with the property. And the purpose of this agreement, frankly, is to make it as condo-like as possible, but they have to do it this way because it's not a condo. Ashley, tell us about the TIC agreement.
Yeah, well, thanks, Dan. And you know, KDV, we've been doing TIC agreements now. We launched our TIC product earlier this year. We're doing tons of these now. Let's talk first about what's in it and what are you looking for kind of when you're shopping around looking for a TIC agreement. So the most important thing is that this should keep me from going into your unit, Dan, and eating out of your fridge. It's going to give you that exclusive use that you don't have under regular common law of a TIC owner. It's going to decide where you get to park, where you get to live, what stairs you get to use, what is our garage storage situation. Another important thing, and this is here, I'm not going to just read this whole slide, but TIC agreements prohibit what's called partition. So it means that, Dan, if you and I get into a fight, I can't go and force the sale of the property. In normal TIC interests, you can just force your other TIC owners to sell. And that becomes a real problem. These TIC disputes, if you don't have a good TIC agreement, get really nasty sometimes and very expensive. And so taking away that ability to force your other TIC owners into a sale is really important.
And that's one of the things the agreement says. So just to underscore that, David, have you ever done a partition action where you were assigned by the court to sell a property?
No.
So I've done this a few times, and typically it's a couple who were not married, who bought together with some expectation that they would get married. They bought as TIC owners, each with a 50% interest. And then the fight started, and now one forces the sale and it's ugly. And so one of the things that's important in here is to take that right away from any of these four owners. So they've agreed that if something goes wrong, that's not on the table. They're not selling the whole building and dividing the proceeds based on their ownership interest.
Right, and think of it, it gets even more disastrous if we have a 6-unit building, right? And there's no TIC agreement and you're forcing the sale, and 6 people are about to get displaced. I mean, it's insane. We see this a lot with families and siblings too, where a family member has left a building to a bunch of different people without a TIC agreement. So look, these are the rules of the road for how are we gonna do this agreement together. I think when you're shopping around, you know, what you're looking for, I think, is not the longest agreement, not the most complicated agreement. You don't need a special binder. What you want in a TIC agreement is an instruction manual that you can actually understand. You want to be able to know how to use it, how voting works, where do I go to figure out building maintenance, utilities, a reserve fund, financing if someone sells. And the longer is not better, right? Referencing Section 6.2.5A3 does not help people figure out how to use these agreements. I litigated TIC disputes for years before I ever started working on drafting. And what I've learned is the better and more readable the instruction manual, the less likely people are unable to put it together. And so that's what we've been working on, Dan. We've been trying to create something here that is a good agreement that has everything you need, but that lets owners figure out how to make use of their own agreements. And then we don't have to get back involved on the litigation side.
What about CC&R? So David, one of the things that we see as agents is we get a preliminary title report and we know that it's a condo. And so we look at CC&Rs. Is it fair to say that this TIC agreement is in place of the CC&Rs?
Yes, I mean, there's a lot of similarities between the terms in the TIC agreement and the terms in CC&Rs. In fact, if you're going through a conversion with other people, first off, the TIC partnership, the terms that you agree there should be represent a segue into the terms that are going to be in CC&Rs. So, and the attorneys who've been involved, in my case, Barbara Herzig, who's now associated with KDV, did my TIC agreements and then my CC&Rs.
Great, I appreciate that. Let's go on to the next slide, Jen. And so that actually is interesting. So does this TIC agreement get recorded? And the reason I say that is because the CC&Rs get recorded, but from what I understand, David and Ashley, we don't record the TIC agreement.
We don't. No, it's a private agreement. As you have here, a couple things get recorded, but the actual TIC agreement is between the parties. And it's their agreement. It always gets disclosed as part of the disclosure package. So you know what you're buying into.
And so because this is an agreement between the owners, David, what kind of care do you take to make sure when you're involved in a TIC transaction, to make sure that all of the owners appear on some roster of owners and that there's documentation that shows that each of them have signed the current TIC agreement? Is that part of what the agents are doing in this transaction?
Yes, normally the TIC agreement will have addenda, which records the original ownerships and the original percentages, and then also documents any individual transfers of the TIC interest. So those need to be maintained over the life of the TIC.
And what's interesting about that is, just to underscore why this is important, is imagine that you did have a 6-unit building, but one of the 6 has not signed the TIC agreement. I think it would be fair then to say, Ashley, that they can't be held to the standards. And so they could sleep in any bed, eat out of any refrigerator, and they could, in fact, if they chose, force a partition. Is that right? Ish?
Hey Dan, I'm having to check over here. Maybe David can answer that one.
Yeah. So that was a bit of a rhetorical question. The answer is yes. We need to make sure that all of the participants have signed the current TIC agreement. Well, this is a good time to bring Sam in, because let's look at our next slide. So Sam, the first time I sold a unit as an agent to clients who were doing buying a TIC interest, they had to get a group loan. There were 4 of them. And part of the whole process was everybody meeting and talking with the lender and getting everybody on a group loan. And if and when any of them sold, it was their understanding that the new owner would need to refinance with all of them unless there was some assumption clause in the original loan. That sounds very complicated. Sam, tell us how the financing works today. Are there still group loans? What does one do?
Yeah, there still are group loans, but more so in smaller buildings. So we'll commonly see 2 individuals, they'll buy a 2-unit building, you know, best of friends, they'll buy it together, just get one large loan. And then typically what happens is a life event. Someone gets married or looks to move, and then they'll need to break up that group loan into fractional financing. So while the group loans are still available, We specialize in the fractional financing, in which we're just loaning to your percentage of ownership in the building itself. And so it eliminates a lot of the headache that Dan was referring to. Early on, about the last, I'm gonna say 7-8 years ago, that was very common, the group loans. And we spent a lot of time trying to break them up, giving everyone fractional loans. And usually, again, as that happens, when someone goes to sell, then we'll try to give them each their own individual fractional loan. So that's the new way they're structured now.
We can't have a hybrid though. So either the four units are four fractional loans or it's one group loan. Is that right?
Correct. Correct.
And so if anyone wants to get a fractional loan and they're on a group loan, they got to get everybody onto the fractional.
Correct. Which usually happens when we have that life event and someone's like, I need to get a fractional loan now. You then have to convince three other owners who have no interest to try to get their own fractional loan. So the earlier you can start that process, the better.
And the fractional loan is sort of a it's like a fiction that was created by the lenders, where the lender says, yes, I recognize that the security interest is an undivided interest in the whole building. Mm-hmm. But if and when you stop paying on your $700,000 loan, as opposed to the group loan of $2.8 million, perhaps, when you stop paying on your $700,000, I may foreclose, but the way I'm going to foreclose is I'm going to foreclose on your interest, not on the whole building. I'm not going to upset the apple cart, and I'm going to force a sale by hiring David Parry to sell your individual TIC interest. Is that right?
Precisely. And as a lender, we're going to rely primarily on the TIC agreement and the language in there that will allow us to foreclose on just that percentage of ownership and making sure that everyone signed it, as you mentioned, just so we can enforce it. So that's exactly how it works now.
Appreciate that.
And let's talk about why people still do group loans.
Please, why don't you and Sam tell us?
There are a couple of reasons that I've seen in putting TIC partnerships together. I think the main one is the flexibility of matching up people, some of whom might want to put down as little as possible, maybe a 5 or 10% down payment, and whereas others might not want to carry a lot of debt, so they might have the cash and to put down 50%. By the time you match those people up, you've got a conventional 20 or 25% down payment group loan. And the second reason is that in those straightforward cases, the interest rates that you pay on the terms of the group loan might be slightly advantageous compared to fractional interest financing. Mm-hmm. Those are the two main reasons why group loans still have some attraction.
And what are your thoughts there, Sam? That tracks with your experience?
Yeah, I definitely agree. Early on, as I said, the interest rates really are what drive someone's ability to want to lean towards the group loan. And as long as there's a very clear understanding, this is what we're walking into now. Later on, we'll build up some equity and potentially get our own fractional loans. It makes a really great buying opportunity for those individual borrowers walking into the scenario.
Well, let's talk about those deltas then. So we've obviously seen a real movement in interest rates in the last 3-4 months. I refinanced, I hate to rub it in, but I refinanced it like 2.5% about a year ago on my 30-year fixed here in San Francisco, jumbo loan. That obviously is not available anymore, but I remember at the time the delta with the TICs was quite substantial. I think at the time the TIC fractional financing was 5-ish%. And in my recollection was they were either 5 or 7 year fixed with variable rates after. Mm-hmm. So in today's market where we have 30-year fixed at approximately 5.5%, where are the TIC loans and what are the terms?
Yeah, so with Bank of San Francisco, we only do adjustable rate mortgages. We have primarily three different types, a 3-year arm, a 7-year arm, and a 10-year arm, where they each fix for that first duration and then variable every year afterwards. To avoid the onslaught of emails of what are the current rates? How low can you go? I'll say from a general standpoint right now, we're in the early threes for our TIC financing. And so it's very competitive from an ARM perspective. And we even do those same or similar rates for condos or single family homes, just being a portfolio lender and our ability to set our rates. So right now the rates are very good for the market and the TICs.
And what's the delta now? So what were your fixed rates? Are you fixed for, you're fixed for how many years before you turn variable?
Yeah, so I'll speak to our 10-year ARM. That's the most popular product and our longest fixed term, where it's fixed for 10 years and the rates are in the early threes and then they vary every year afterwards. And we found most of our clients, they're usually refinancing or having life events every 5 to 7 years. So that 10-year ARM has been a very popular product lately.
So let me make sure I understand that, because that sounds quite attractive to me. Mm-hmm. I can get a 10-year, and I'm going to call it a 10-year fixed because that's what it is. It's fixed for 10 years, variable thereafter. Mm-hmm. Somewhere in the threes right now on fractional financing?
Correct.
And that's
in the early threes right now.
That crushes the non-TIC purchase loan, doesn't it?
Correct. It does.
Well, that's really interesting because there's been a discount for a TIC. And one of the reasons there's been a discount is not only it's not as great as a condo for the reasons Ashley's been explaining, but also because the financing wasn't as good. David, if the financing is better for a TIC right now, this is going to help the agents really push some of the clients to this alternative, yes?
Yes, I mean, if those rates sound really attractive, you're the exception in being able to get a 30-year fix for the kind of rate that you got. But in general, I don't recommend paying the premium at the time for a 30-year fix, because typically people are not going to have that same loan for more than 10 years. Mm-hmm. So, there was a question earlier, I think, from Rob Edwards about what triggered the move towards fractional financing. And I think the short answer to that is the flexibility that is gained so that individual owners can sell their individual TIC interests without disturbing or putting the other partners into a refinance and having to requalify the group for a group loan. So I think it was that flexibility that triggered the introduction of fractional interest financing.
And imagine, of course, the scenario where the loan rates have changed substantially as they are now. So it's possible that that group loan was at 4%, but for this, you know, 4-unit building, there may not be a group loan at lower than, 6% right now, let's say. And that would really change things. Mm-hmm. Ashley, have we missed anything? Have you heard us say anything that you say, oh God, that's wrong?
No, I think you guys you're killing it. I totally agree. I have lots of clients. I remember kind of pre-fractionalized loan days where, we were trying to refinance when someone would sell and it would cause all these problems. So I think I'm delighted to hear that Sam's doing loans at these deals. I think it'll make it easier to pitch.
Sam, what have we missed? So what is different for you? The qualifications are different. The down payment is different. The time to get an appraisal is different. Are they appraising the whole building or just the unit? Is it a 30? Can you do this and get us an answer in 21 days? What is different? Tell us.
Qualifications are pretty much the same for a regular condo, a single family home. I'm looking for a minimum FICO of 700. I'm looking for 12 months of liquidity, 2 years of employment history. A maximum debt to income ratio, 43%. All that is the same. The real key difference is from a down payment perspective, we require 25% for the TICs as opposed to the traditional 20%. From a close of escrow timeframe, typically it's about 25 days now on average. Our biggest issue lately, honestly, have been the appraisal turn times. There are handful of TIC appraisers pre-pandemic, and now that we've gotten into the heat of it and past of it, there just aren't that many TIC appraisers left. So the few there, typically it's about 14 to 17 days just to get through the appraisal process. But we get through everything else while we're waiting for that to still try to close escrow within 25 to 30 days.
And although you're here representing, of course, the Bank of San Francisco, there are a few others who do this. If you don't mind, tell us approximately how many there are. I know that number often changes. We have people coming in and out of the field. Mm-hmm. And are there some different products that others provide different from what you provide?
Oh, yeah. I want to say now there are about 3 to 4 consistently active lenders. We get some new ones that come in and out here and there, about 3 to 4 that are consistent. Some have a lower down payment requirement, 20% down for the TICs. There are some longer fixed terms. So there's even a couple of 30-year fixed lenders that are available. But again, we're limited to just...
I saw some rates from NCB just recently. Someone texted to me. Thank you, Nicole K. And they have a 30-year fixed, which I think, honestly, I'm thinking about what David said, which is really, what are the chances of someone being in this product for more than 10 years?
Some borrowers like that comfort, though, of saying, at least I'm fixed for 30 years, but then usually around year 5 or 7, they've got that life event to get them to move on. So depends on their comfort level.
Okay. Appreciate that. And I interrupted. I'm sorry. You were saying that some of the differences. So some people have a lower down payment. Some offer a 30-year. Are there any other distinct differences where your bank may not be the right bank for somebody because they need this other thing that works better that you don't offer?
Primarily the down payment, on the points. So we charge a 1% origination fee. That's 1% of the loan amount. Not every lender does that. They might charge none with a higher rate. We've chosen a very simple model. You get a very low interest rate. You pay a 1% origination fee up front. And that's it. It's a very simple model that we run for TICs.
And so the 1% is 1 point. That's what we refer to as points. And that's 1 point being 1% of the loan amount. And so if it's an $800,000 loan amount, that's $8,000 upfront in additional fees.
Correct.
What about the square footage? So I saw this weird thing recently, and Nicole K is reminding me, thank you, Nicole, that some people won't lend on a TIC that's too small, right? What's that all about?
It's more so, well, I'll preface that with, we don't have a minimum square footage requirement.
Right.
The general concern there is that the saleability of it. If you have a, as we've seen,
a micro
200 square foot unit, how saleable is that in the long run? And lenders, of course, want to protect our interests just to make sure that we're not stuck with a 200 square foot unit in a TIC building. But again, Bank of San Francisco, we don't have a square footage limitation.
Okay. And speaking of which, are there any different appraisal standards that you have?
I can say the appraisal standards are specific to the institution. And so with our appraisal process, we typically require only TIC comps to be used. And we do that primarily because it's become very challenging to value a TIC versus condo.
Right.
And a recent assessment just shown you have to get granular to the specific area in the city to further help explain that justification. TICs versus condos are different in Marin than they're in Noe Valley. It's going to vary depending upon the area. So for us, we only use TIC comps in our valuation.
Appreciate that. All right. So, you know, I know this is a little unusual, but do we want to open up the mic for a moment for financing questions? And we still have more presentation to go and a lot of interesting topics. But I was wondering if we wanted to open up the mics now for any financing questions. Who has a financing question? And Genevieve, is that even possible? Can people speak?
Yeah, I can allow them in to speak. So it looks like Steve has a question. Oh.
Hey, Dan, we have a bunch in the Q&A and chat. Do you want me to just pitch the financing ones to Sam?
Yes, I would love that. Ashley, do that for us, please.
All right. So, Sam, here we go. Who can you give us a list of the consistent TIC lenders in San Francisco? Who are the people who have been doing it the whole time?
Bank of San Francisco, Sterling Bank historically was one, but the last that I heard, they're not doing TIC financing anymore, residential lending. Then I did hear that they might start again in December. I haven't got clarity on that. From my understanding, they're no longer doing residential lending. National Cooperative Bank,
NCB.
NCB, Patel Co. and Redwood Credit Union.
Yep.
And then Merry West is another one. The latter ones haven't been in the market too long, but most of them have seasoned individuals that work on their team to help do TICs.
And Sam, people are also saying maybe Bank of Marin as well.
Oh, I thought I mentioned them. Sorry. Yes, Bank of Marin.
Okay. A lot of questions. Is the loan assumable?
It is assumable. We charge a 1% origination fee for it to be assumable. So very few times does someone actually go assumable. They'll likely just get their own. And being that we've been historically in a declining interest rate environment, you're likely better off getting a newer loan at a newer rate as opposed to assuming someone else's.
But that's very interesting, because if we continue to be in a market where the rates are increasing, this is actually something David Parry's going to end up putting on his flyer, right? So he's going to be selling the TIC unit, and he's going to say that the current interest rate is 3.45%. There's 7 years left on the loan, and it's assumable.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Right? Sam, they're also hoping you can touch on finances around condo conversion and the requirement to refi. So what happens when someone's going through condo conversion? Now they're on maybe a fractionalized loan, but now they're going to be a condo. They're going to refi, right?
Yeah. So typically the final step is to refinance your loan. Without getting too technical, you're moving, that allows you to move your loan from the building's parcel ID to your new individual condo parcel ID. And so you refinance, you obtain a new loan on your new parcel ID. That's the final step in the condo conversion.
Perfect. Another question, in a scenario where everyone has fractional loans in place and one owner defaults, what happens? Do the other TIC owners have risk liability on the property level?
The other owners, and this is where the TIC agreement really comes into play. With the strong TIC agreement, the other owners, they're more so on the hook for the shared expenses, property taxes, insurance, maintenance, things like that. But for the loan itself, the lender can only foreclose on their percentage of ownership. The other owners wouldn't be responsible for that.
Exactly. And I'll just add in here, this is why you want a strong TIC agreement, because you don't want your property taxes not to be getting paid. You don't want sort of the building to be falling in disrepair while the bank forecloses and then resells that ownership interest. Correct. So I think someone was asking me that.
Ashley, do you know any attorneys or law firms that put together such strong agreements?
I do actually. I work at one. So yes, we're very delighted to provide that service now. I'm really proud of what we've put together. And I think those are,
I did see one question on there asking about secondary market.
Yes.
That's a great question. And so spoken to a number of secondary market lenders over the years. And I think the overall consensus is, because it's such a niche product to just the Bay Area, an aggregator doesn't want to actively say, I'm going to buy these TIC loans that are just in the Bay Area, limited to just this particular footprint. And for context, a secondary market, typically when a lender does a loan, they have the ability to sell it to someone else and to get a gain on sale. And with TICs, there is no active secondary market, a lender or an investor that's going to buy those loans from the original lender. And so while there've been many talks, and we get a lot of start-stop conversations on aggregators looking into it and considering it, we haven't had anyone consistent to say, yes, we will actively buy these TIC loans on an ongoing basis.
Does that mean at some point you guys may stop because your portfolio is too big?
So when the program really began to grow in the Bay Area, we did a really deep assessment on what other lenders were doing and why maybe they stopped doing TICs, and developed our program based off of that. How can we create a consistent or an ongoing program? And being Bank of San Francisco, we don't want to be one to say we're in now and now we're out. And so overall, we may not be the cheapest game in town, may not be, you know, the ones that are going to get there with the lowest cost or the lowest interest rate, but our program is built to be here as long as possible. We have no plans on stop financing TICs.
And I'll just point everyone to the chat. Nicole put a lovely list with contact information at all the different banks that are doing TIC loans. So thank you. I think that's super helpful to everyone. One more for you, Sam. If you purchase a TIC on a 10-year ARM, can you refi at year 8 and for another 10-year ARM?
You can. You can refinance at any time and obtain a new TIC loan, which is very common for those that stay in for the longer duration. You can just refinance at any given time. There's no prepayment penalty to do so.
Is there typically a 1-point charge for even a refi?
With our program, you're still paying that 1% origination fee for it. But again, we try to price our rates low enough where you're offsetting that the longer you hold the loan.
Okay. All right, well, those were good questions. Sam, stick around, there might be more. Or if you hear us talking about something that is relevant to lending, please jump in and say exactly what we need to hear.
Sure. I have a question for Sam.
Go ahead.
Sam, on some older TICs, some older TIC agreements, do you guys come across terms that you need to have changed in the agreement before you'll lend on it?
Unfortunately, yes. I've ballparked where anything prior to 2010 may not have language that allows fractional financing. It may allude to it or have something that kind of skirts around it, but not specifically saying you can get fractional financing. And so typically early on in the process, we'll have the TIC agreement reviewed, assuming you haven't done finance in the building already. And we'll be able to say early on if an amendment is needed and what kind of provisions are needed. Most of the TIC's attorneys, including Ashley, will be able to draft up some sort of amendment or addendum that has to illustrate the fractional TIC in language, and that has to be executed then by all the owners that are in the building.
And so
mediation and arbitration clauses? Do you run across agreements which are insufficient in those areas?
Not that I can recall. Early on, there were some of the earlier agreements would not have an arbitration clause, or maybe they would have language that would require an Ellis Act or something near there, but not specifically that though.
Okay, that was actually, so David, that's a wonderful tip there, which is the moment you take a listing on a TIC, that the first thing you need to do is get the TIC agreement and get it in front of a firm or an attorney who is doing actively locally TIC agreements to make sure it has in it what a lender is going to need to make this thing happen. And so imagine the cooperation that's required, and it is, right? And so you need to know as soon as possible how to approach the group, show them what the changes need to be, and hopefully you're selling it like this, which is at some point, any or all of you might also wish to sell your property, and the agreement needs to be updated to make that happen. All right, let's see what the next slide has. Ah, yes. So what contract documents are required? So we have a TIC advisory that explains what a TIC is. And a lot of listing agents have the TIC advisory with them and available at an open house, because the first question one always has at an open house is, what is a TIC and how is it different from a condo? And so you need both an elevator pitch, right? And I would suggest providing them with the actual TIC advisory. Our purchase agreement has a TIC addendum. And on the first page of our purchase agreement, David Parry and his forms committee have made a very simple checkbox for us to say, this is in fact a sale of a TIC. And then you enter in the percentage of ownership. And when you check that box, it will bring up into your transaction the TIC purchase addendum. Just like our condo financial disclosure statement, we have a similar financial disclosure statement for TICs, and we will be asking some other person in the TIC, quote, association, and I'm putting that in quotes, because it is no CID, it's not a common interest development, it's not an HOA, but it is a group of co-owners, and hopefully one of them would be willing to fill out this form for you. We do a vacant unit disclosure technically in San Francisco, Whenever we sell a multi-unit building where one of them is going to be delivered vacant, we must provide the vacant unit disclosure. In this case, it's pretty darn easy. And then we do, if it is a residential 1-4, the seller is required to do a TDS. You as the agent are required to do an AVID, but the unique situation here is that the TDS and the AVID needs to be for the whole property because you're selling an interest in the whole property. So if your seller is aware that there are defects in the neighbor's unit and that the neighbor is having problems with electrical or heat or noise or whatever it might be, they need to disclose that. You have to do an AVID of the whole building. But of course, it's only the accessible areas. And so if the neighbors don't allow you into their unit to do an AVID of their units, then you will be making a notation in your AVID that you are not given access to units A, B, and C, and it only pertains to D, and that you are unable to get access, okay? All right, let's see what the next slide is. Okay, so this one's sort of fun. There's this, and Ashley, you can speak to this. What's amusing about this is in the TIC agreement, sometimes there will be responsibilities of the neighbors that will be tied to their percentage of ownership. So how much they're paying towards common electric if there's a separate meter, or garbage if they share the garbage expense, or the quote unquote common area lawn maintenance, whatever it might be. And so what's funny about that is that ironically, now there's some incentive for them to have a smaller percentage of ownership. The only real reason you'd want a larger percentage of ownership is if you sold the whole building and divided the proceeds based on the percentage of ownership. But because we don't have a right to a partition action, that doesn't exist. So in some ways, the percentage of ownership interest is arbitrary. Ashley, anything relevant to add to discuss about that?
The only thing I'll say is that sometimes this turns into what I consider the most ridiculous fight between the prospective co-owners, where they're, you know, we're going to own 32.3% and the other, you know, 33 and then 34. And they think it matters. And it absolutely doesn't, because we're going to divide up who pays what fairly in a way that everyone agrees to. So I do see people spending inordinate amounts of time fighting about this, kind of to no avail. So I agree that it is ironic.
Speaking of a fair percentage of payments, tell us how the taxes work. So David, you, I know, have experience in this also. And so what do you pay in terms of taxes, and what are owed to the city? Does the city care that there are different fractional ownerships? Does the city just send out one bill? And then what does the TIC agreement do about collecting taxes? Is there an impound account, et cetera? David and Ashley, tell us.
The city just sends out one bill because it's still an undivided property as far as the city's concerned, just still a single lot. And so the TIC agreement has to dictate whether or not money's been collected in advance in order to have enough funds to pay the taxes when they're due in November and February each year. And on a change of a fractional ownership, that's going to trigger a recalculation, which sometimes the assessor's office needs a little help with to explain what just happened. And so the assessed value for the parcel will get increased typically if the value of that individual interest is greater than the seller paid for it in the first place. And so it leads to a fairly complicated calculation on the taxes going forward. And there are two or three bookkeepers or accountants who specialize in helping TIC groups for whom this might be too complicated for them to handle themselves.
And I'd heard that, well, two things. One is I'd like to say that our local tax assessor has done a nice job of understanding what TICs are, and they don't reassess the entire property at the time of a fractional interest transfer, which they otherwise could, but they just don't. And so as David said, if the seller of the fractional interest bought theirs for $400,000 and are now selling for $800,000, the reassessment is going to be $400,000 increase, and the new owner is supposed to pay based on the Prop 13 purchase value of $800,000 for that unit, and everybody else should stay the same. There shouldn't be an increase. Ashley, what I heard was that in addition to these bookkeepers, sometimes the firms like yours who do the TIC addendum will have calculators and such and will assist in making sure that everybody is paying the right tax amount. Is that right, or is that just wishful thinking?
I mean, that's pretty much wishful thinking. What we'll do is we'll draft up what everybody agrees on. We do a fair amount of counseling, it feels like, with getting everyone on the same page and sort of making sure. I mean, we do it. We spend a lot of time talking about taxes and floor coverings, to be perfectly honest. But it's a lot of counseling. But no, we recommend the same firms. We try to sort of, we are not tax attorneys. We would never pretend to be. And so we try to sort of outsource that piece of it. And then, you know, once everyone gets on the same page with what they want to do, we know how to get that into your agreement and make it enforceable.
Cool. Thank you. I appreciate that. Okay, let's see what our next slide shows us. Okay, so some things are based on percentage of ownership, right? And I tried to put out some examples here. Insurance, maintenance, utilities, HOA reserves, if they do that, maybe they don't even do that. What about voting shares? That's not based on percentage of ownership, is it?
Usually not, depends. You can structure it that way if you want to. You can sort of define how you want votes to be, but normally that is not how we do it. We do it based on either unit count or number of units. So no, usually it is not. I've seen some very old TIC agreements though that sort of even give or try to give extra votes to sort of the original creators of the TIC so they can try to like maintain control. So again, it's all going to be based on the TIC agreement itself. And people divide things up in different ways. I've seen TIC agreements that have a unanimous consent clause. That
sounds terrible.
It's terrible, but in like a three unit building, sometimes it actually makes neighbor life easier if everyone just has to agree or they have to go pay for mediation, right?
Oh, okay.
I don't know. I mean, but it's not, I don't recommend it, but I've seen it.
Well, I guess better than one person feeling bullied all the time, but.
Well, exactly. Especially in like a family where, you know, it's a brother and sister who own two of the units and the third person's like, hey, I don't want to be outranked all the time.
Right. You know, the other thing that reminds me is I owned a two unit in the city and I was considering selling one of the units as TIC, and I had someone draft a TIC agreement for me. And I had a friend who was a graphic artist put together a condo map, basically. Right. And I gave myself all the good stuff.
Yep.
Right. The best storage and the best, you know, et cetera, et cetera. How often do we have the equivalent of a condo map that goes with this TIC agreements that really show where the parking and the storage and all of that really are?
I really like it. I think it's pretty standard these days, especially in these kind of complicated San Francisco scenarios where people are tandem parking or whatever. I think more detail is better. Again, you're trying to create an instruction manual for people who don't like to read instructions. And so the more detail you give them, the better.
I recommend it every time that a newly formed TIC hire a licensed surveyor to put together the map or the plan of the building, and which you can designate individual parking spaces, individual storage spaces, and in doing that, if you are still eligible for a condo conversion, you've often saved an expense down the road if you have a licensed surveyor put that plan together.
Nice, I like that. As opposed to my buddy who is just good with graphics. Okay.
Yeah, exactly.
Let's go on to the next slide. We may be a little short on time, but the next couple slides are little tips for realtors when we sell these things. And so one, of course, is make sure that everybody signed the TIC agreement, update the agreement, get it to somebody like Ashley as soon as you can, right? Include the signed and updated TIC agreement with the disclosures, right? Exhibit A, exclusive use assignments and maps. Locate and include the disclosure packet, the assumption and release of obligations, if you can find that. gather any existing HOA style documents, are there budgets, minutes, insurance, house rules, dues, special assessments, reserve studies, etc. There may or may not be any of that, right? Well, there will be insurance, but they may or may not have a budget. They may have not had meetings. They may not have reserve study. They may not have bank accounts, but we want to treat it like an HOA if that stuff exists. Include the TIC financial disclosure statement in your disclosure packet. Refer the sellers to a local TIC attorney to prepare an opinion letter regarding possible condo conversion. And the reason I say this is I don't want you to speculate, because you're always going to get that question at the open house, right? What is a TIC? What is a condo? What's the difference? And can this thing be converted into a condo? That shouldn't come from you. That should be from either the buyer's own research, or if an attorney is willing to put an opinion letter together for a fee, and you can add that to your disclosure packet. But your answer is, I can't give you that legal opinion. You need to investigate that, okay? Title report, do we have all the owner's names, right? Do we have all of them who have signed the, and making sure that all of them have signed the TIC agreement. Let's go on to the next slide. And the buyer's agent, right? You're doing the same thing. You're doing your best to make sure that we have in fact had everybody sign off on the agreement. We make sure that the agreement has been updated so that it has what your lender needs it to have, right? And so as soon as possible, get that TIC agreement to your lender. Please don't remove the contingency to review the TIC agreement or the contingency for financing until you have had the lender review that TIC agreement. And so this is a reminder, it does not matter how well qualified your clients are. All loans, whether on a condo, a single family home, or a TIC, have two areas which they need to be approved. The buyer's financial wherewithal needs to be approved, and the property needs to be approved. And so that's doubly important here with the TIC. Okay, next slide. A contingency review. So you have a contingency to review and approve the TIC agreement as part of the TIC addendum. You can waive that if you've already reviewed the TIC agreement, but in the TIC addendum is a contingency, right? Make sure your client has not removed that contingency until they have all the information that they need. Next. The disclosures, we talked about them. It's a disclosure of the entire unit, the entire building. And so we need to make sure that if the seller has information about the other quote unquote units, that that's disclosed, because the seller is selling the whole building, right? Just a percentage of ownership. Next one. And so if you have TIC contingency language for friends coming together who are intending to do a condo conversion, this is that language. We're not going to go through this now, but some of these things you want to consider. You want to talk with an attorney about it. And Genevieve will have this presentation, which is being recorded on our YouTube channel. And so you can scroll ahead and take a look at this language at that time. The same with the next slide, which is additional terms for a new TIC development. So if the we see this quite often, a four-unit apartment building was purchased, then Ellis acted, a developer of sorts, a contractor has come in, rehabbed all of the buildings, and now we're selling all of the units. Sometimes there's some very specific language that we see. This is a model of some of that language to take to your attorney to help decide whether or not this needs to be inside your offer, okay? All right, let's open it up to finishing questions and to thank our guests and our panelists and David and Ashley and Sam. First of all, thank you so much. Second, is there something that we've forgotten or got wrong that you'd like to add now? Sam, anything?
Everything sounds pretty good. The one thing I do want to highlight that was referenced to the HOA bookkeeping. I can't tell you how many times there's been an internal bookkeeper or someone that thinks they know bookkeeping and did it on their own. And then there's a reassessment and it's like, oh my gosh, I didn't know this was going to happen. So one of the best pieces of advice I can give is just try to convince your clients to hire an outside bookkeeper just to handle all that. I think offhand they charge, it's like $25 or $30 a month per unit. it's a really good investment to avoid any issues down the line.
It sounds very cheap. Thank you, Sam, for that practical advice. David?
I think the only thing we haven't discussed is for the two-unit buildings, which can still be converted to condominiums today, if you're buying as a TICs, buying the two units individually, it's very important to look at the eviction and buyout history that the building might have, because that can prevent condo conversion.
Yeah, so if we have an Ellis Act, for instance, or if we have more than one owner being bought out, those are two reasons the statute says it can't convert. So it's like a scarlet letter that's slapped on these things in certain circumstances. But of course, you would want to confirm that with someone like Ashley Klein.
Yeah, the only thing I was going to add, Dan, is that I think we need a YPN, do another one on condo conversion, because I'm seeing question after question about condo conversion. David's absolutely right. If you think you want to buy a two-unit building, you have to get to landlord-tenant council. I do that a lot. And make sure you're eligible. If you're doing buyouts, you have to be super careful. There are ways to get around this. But we have to be careful and cognizant of our intention to condo convert. So,
and I would remind us that the paragraph 12 investigation contingency is a lot more than inspections. And it right. talks about the future use of the building, right? And so if your clients are buying a property thinking that in the future they can condo convert, make sure they haven't removed what they sometimes call their inspection contingency, because it would also be the investigation of what they can do in the future, sitting down with somebody like Ashley and finding out what the rules are for condo conversion.
Okay. Right, and there are lots of loopholes, Dan, that we have. I have many rabbits in my hat on preserving condo conversion. So if we get that one booked, I would love to explore those.
Okay, and perhaps we could do that. Ashley, I'm gonna call this thing a success. I would like to award some medals. The gold medal, of course, goes to David, who I've known the longest. The silver medal will go to Ashley. And Sam, you're going to get the bronze medal, but here's why. There's an interesting poll of Olympians. The happiest is the gold medalist. The next happiest by far is the bronze medalist. And the least happy is the silver medalist. The silver medalist always thinking what I could have done to get the gold. The bronze medalist being thrilled that they are on the podium and thanking God that they're not in fourth place, just having missed. So we're gonna leave you with a good feeling because you have a medal and I am in fourth place sitting there with nothing, wringing my hands, thinking what I could have done differently. All right, thank you everybody. It is officially a success.
Thank you everyone.
Appreciate it.
Thank you.
Ashley, thank you to YPN for putting this together.
We will do another event. We have our next YPN meeting this week. So we'll probably talk about putting on a TIC conversion event.
Excellent. And maybe you and I can get the gold medals. We could tie. Yeah,
exactly.
No, Sam and I are coming.
Right? Yeah. Pull us out.
All right. Bye, everybody.
Bye. 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 Thanks.